7654321.
You'll never have the sacred stone.
Oh, this you crazy mother.
Well, how about that?
All right, cool. How about that?
How about that?
All right, another week down. Got through Minneapolis. Dungy didn't win. Shocker. Just kidding, it's not really. He is struggling hard.
But didn't you pick him to win, though?
I did in the video.
Like, however, later on I changed
after, after practice, I did not. But anywho, so Dunge doesn't win. Tomac wins. Marv passes Dunge. Savachi opens the East Coast with a win.
Osborne
AC gets a solid fifth.
Osborne surprised the hell out of us.
Osborne runs good all day. Wow, we got some stuff to talk
about.
Yes,
we do.
All right, so we'll jump into it right after this. Okay, 250 class. Let's start off with them. Let's start right at the top. Joey Savachi gets the win. Not a surprise to anyone, I don't think.
I mean,
he looked all right all day, went out. He did exactly what he needed to do. He freaking went in, got a good start, made a quick pass, boom, in the lead, checking out. See you later, bye.
Yeah, he, I mean, I picked him to win. He's my title favorite for the year. He did what we expected. You know, he didn't look the greatest, but like you just said, he did just enough to win on a sketchy track that didn't flow. And, you know, he's got a points lead. And like I said, I think with Coop being gone, his kryptonite's not there anymore, and he's confident. Although it did take a little bit longer to get around Jordan than I thought he would.
Yeah, and Jordan Smith didn't hit the deck, which was a huge disappointment for me.
Neither did RJ Shamshire.
No, neither did RJ. Neither one of them hit the deck, because those two are guaranteed. In fact, when the race started, I text you like 3 minutes in, and I go, $10. Jordan hits the deck.
And then I go, they just cross over on each other and take both of each other out.
Yeah, RJ and Jordan cross over, they'll both crash, whatever. I mean, they're nice kids, but they just can't stay off the deck, so whatever. But good ride by Jordan Smith, too.
Is kind of living, I mean, that
living
was one
up
race.
To the hype that he had coming in, because he was pretty hyped kid coming in of like, hey, he's going to do well, and he has not done shit up till this point, so.
Bike looked good, though.
Bike looked good. He looked good. His teammate, Alex Martin, did not look good.
Did not look good.
It's all night.
Something about the Martin luck, man, because this year it is not working for them.
Nope, absolutely not. You want to know what I heard the other day?
What's that?
Mike LaRocco was at the test track with Jeremy Martin and got on his bike and rode it to make sure it was working okay.
And if most of you don't know, Michael LaRocco was about a good 210, 215, and Jeremy Martin's maybe 105 pounds.
Soaking wet. So anyway, all right, so third place, Zach Osborne. Great night for Wacko Zacko.
Yep.
Freaking great night. He was awesome in qualifying. He looked good in his heat race. If he wouldn't have hit neutral, and I've talked to you about this, I think he would have made a push, and he would have probably gotten real close to Savachi and made him nervous, if not gotten Savachi, because he was the fastest dude by far the fastest dude in the 250 class. So you know, good showing for him. Next guy on the list would to talk about.
Hampshire got fourth,
but AC whatever. AC, fifth place, went out. Good night. Second in this heat race to Savachi, was right with him. Got an okay start in the main. Worked his way to fifth. I mean, he didn't crash and hurt his shoulder.
No.
We're good.
And they had to do a segment on that.
Yes.
Yeah, just to make, you know,
just to make sure everyone knew. But he got it. He made it through the race. He finished. We're good. That's somewhere to build on. I like that kid a lot. I didn't like him as much when he was younger, but I like him a lot now. I think he's a funny dude. He's good. He's good. I like him.
I still think the biggest disappointment, though, after how his heat race went was, and granted he didn't get a good start, was Christian.
Christian Craig.
He looked on in that heat race, dude. He was flawless.
Huge letdown of the night.
Yep.
All we talked about all week, everybody talked about, was Craig Savachi battling it out.
Yep.
And we didn't get that at all.
No, and how many rounds in do you think if he continues to struggle before he fires David Villeman?
Well, see, the problem was there wasn't a lot of whoops there last
night. Yeah,
yeah. The Cobra would have had him attacking the whoops, but...
But that was, in my opinion, I know that Amart, you know, pulling off, that might be a big disappointment to people, but Christian, after how he looked during practice, all the hype, and then in the heat race, going out and looking flawless, you know, smooth, and even the way that track not flowing suit his style, you know, he's just so effortless, doesn't use a ton of energy, and... That was a big letdown, and I mean, it was one race, you know, but I mean, with how on it the guys are this year, one race, that might have been the championship right there, because I even though Hill had won the last four on the West Coast, I don't think you're going to see the back and forth topsy turvy between the top four guys like on the West Coast. I think it's going to be, you know, Joey and AC, and now the reemergence of Osborne every week. I don't think it's going to be, you know, nobody's going to get in there one week. I think it's basically going to be those guys, even though there's a lot deeper talent on the East Coast, in my opinion.
There's a lot of dudes on the East. I was watching last night, and I was like, holy shit, there's a lot more guys than I even thought about.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Lining up. Like, you can't even cover them all.
No, like Renslin, you know, we didn't talk about him.
Yeah.
Gaines did good, you know, but to my point.
We could talk for an hour just about the 250 class, I think.
I think that one race might have just cost Christian a championship. Now, I know that's wild to assume this quickly, but... Dude, you can't spot Joey that many points on the first race.
You just
can't. So
if Savacci doesn't have a breakdown like he did in outdoors last year, it's gonna be rough for Craig to catch him and beat him here. And Craig's gonna have to step his shit up a lot too. So
and unfortunately, touch on the last point. When we go to Daytona, that's gonna be Christian's biggest struggle. And I'm sorry. I like Christian, and I know it's only one round, but that might have just cost him the championship before he even had a chance to get, you know, go for it. So,
like they always say, you can't win the championship on the opener,
sure,
but you can lose it.
Yep.
Craig lost it. Osborne did a good job of not losing it last night.
Yep.
So
that was good.
But it was a good race. You know, I enjoyed it. The track sucked.
Track
was awful.
Terrible.
But yeah, so I think going forward in the 250 class, like you said, you're looking at Savacci, AC,
Osborne
as your big three there. I don't think there's going to really be any surprises. Although there could be one. There could be one. And you might hate me for this. The Frenchie.
Friend has looked good. He got, I think, 10th in the main. You know, he kind of went back and forth a little bit. He was kind of caught up between, you know, him, McAdoo, Benny, and Mitchell. They were kind of going back and forth, you know, 10th through 14th.
Had a bad start, but
he
looked solid all night. So it'll be interesting once he gets a few Supercross races under his belt here to see where he goes to. So
it's just, can he stay off the ground?
Yep. We'll have to keep an eye on it. We'll see.
But he did good.
But Frenchie don't want none.
Yeah, Frenchie don't want none.
So, that's the 250 class. Okay, moving on. 450 time. The big boys.
Mm-hmm.
Let's start with a couple outline stories before we move into the podium. Number one, Cooper Webb.
Broke collarbone.
Broke a collarbone. Fuck me. Right in the asshole.
Depressing.
Super depressing. Kid had a great run going. Now, luckily, with a collarbone, depending upon how it's broke, they'll screw it back together. He'll be back in 2 weeks. But there goes any chance he has at making any sort of run at a title. Not that I thought he was going to win a title, but...
And I wouldn't even count on that at this point. I think that even if it is something like that, Coop's never been one to take injuries lightly. You know, he does just let it do its thing, run its course.
Mm-hmm.
So it might be an instance, even if it is 2-3 weeks and stuff, you might just see him come back at like round 13 and just start getting ready for outdoors, which at this point he needed. I mean, the championship was out of reach anyway, so I mean, he's a favorite for the outdoors, so why not?
Yeah, so that was kind of sad. Second big story of the night outside of the podium, the return of Bam Bam. Yeah. So, show of hands, who thinks he's going to have a good ride next year? No one.
Exactly.
That dude is, wow.
That's
just
terrible.
Awful.
Absolutely. And he was still riding the rev limiter.
He couldn't do anything. I thought he was going to, you see, forget who it was. Somebody was lapping. I can't remember if it was Marv or Eli or somebody. And he was like looking over at him. And I'm like, watch him just make an immediate left and just take him out.
Sorry, guys.
I can't do nothing else. So I just might as well be the next, you know, Jason Lawrence of the class or something. What do you say about it? It's not. He hasn't done anything since he's gotten off the Honda. I mean, there's just nothing to say about it. He's just overrated, overpaid. I mean, this year I think his contract was less because he had to re-sign since they switched to Suzuki, so he got paid less. But man, I feel bad for JGR. Like, they spent all this money on him. Like, oh, he's the next thing. This is awesome. And now he can't ride the fucking bike to save his life or stay healthy. So
and honestly, you know, obviously Weston's hurt right now, but maybe if Justin doesn't get the ride, and you know, maybe that means they'll start actually focusing their core focus on Weston and actually putting all their efforts toward him, because until Weston got hurt, fucking Weston was killing it.
Yeah,
you know,
so I don't know, maybe Barsha should just go to racing mountain bikes or something.
Maybe he should just fucking go to Europe.
There's been talk of that.
Yeah, well, he'll get fucking waxed even more over there because
his style. But his girlfriend's from England,
I don't really care.
I heard that last week that they were like, "Well, if he doesn't do well this year, you think he'll go to Europe?" And there were people that thought he probably would.
Good, so he'd go get waxed even hardcore.
It's gonna open up ride for somebody who deserves
like Nick
it.
Schmidt.
Nick Schmidt. No, I'm just kidding. Nick Schmidt's never signed a factory deal. He makes way more money doing his own thing.
Exactly.
So. Okay, so those were the letdowns of the night. Let's move on. 450 class, podium. Podium. You want to start at the top or the bottom?
Honestly, I think that we should just start at the top because the bottom is the worst end of it. And I think we have more to talk about on that end.
All right, let's start with the top. Eli dominates again.
Like we kind of figured.
Yep. This is getting kind of scary for people.
Three out of four.
He probably, I mean, y'all can comment whatever the hell you want at the bottom.
But let's
be real. He would have won last week, too, had he not had the brake problems. He was coming through that fucking group like a Mack truck.
And let's be real. He is asserted himself now that Roxon's gone as the fastest guy in the 450 class.
Yep.
Like, you can't just, the first two rounds, like, oh, they could have been a fluke, like, no, like, let's be honest, he is the fastest guy, and he did it with ease.
Mm-hmm.
He did it with ease. Like, when he got a five-second gap, he even backed it down, and he still was pulling away.
Yep.
And then that line through the dragon's back was just poetry in motion.
Yeah, he was good. He was good. That guy, that's it there. Yeah, he, you know, he cranks off another two, three, four in a row here. Four. He's calling it. Stamp it. He's calling it.
Well.
Next four in a row. Are Eli's races.
And the third one is his favorite track of the year. So.
Daytona.
Yeah. Ooh.
So anyway, so I don't know. He cranks off another four in a row. Even if Dunge gets second every week, that's 12 more points. All of a sudden he's what?
Is it 22 or 24 right now?
I think it's 24. So 21. He's 12 down, 26? 26?
Yeah.
No, it's 20. It's gotta be 24, 23.
Because it was 28.
Anyway, all of a sudden you're within like 15 points of first place. Mm-hmm. Even if Dunge gets second the next 4 weeks and he wins. All of a sudden, boom, we got ourselves a race here with, what are we at then? That's six rounds to go. Six rounds to go.
I don't know, people. It's
getting hairy. And wild card, you throw Marv in there.
Who has now
asserted himself as being one of the top guys.
And knows he can beat Dungy.
Knows he can beat Dungy. He can beat Eli if he has to. And he can outright catch and pass Dungy on a shit track.
5.5.
5 seconds down, and he caught and passed Dungy last night. That was impressive, to say the least. So, yeah, this is going to get really, really interesting here over the next... If the next four rounds go like the last three, four rounds have gone, this is going to be a race to the finish.
Well, and like I said, you know, what we were talking about before we started the show with Dungy, you know, other than winning a majority of the races last year, and we talk about it, and same old thing, Diesel podium people to death. Well, eventually you got to start getting at least three or four wins, which Dungy's always never had a problem with, even in the Villopoto and Stewart days. But his biggest claim to, the biggest thing that helped him was he could podium people, but he also, and I'm not going to say luck, even though you create your own luck, I'm going to say it helped him out. That the guys he was battling for the championship were inconsistent. Mm-hmm. Well, now the dude that's won the last three or four races has asserted himself as the fastest guy in the 450 class, is on a roll. The bike finally looks good because they started listening to him. And then your training partner and the guy that's always been the biggest thing is confidence has now proven that he can beat you 2 weeks in a row. So he can get third, but if he keeps getting beat by Tomac and Marv, this championship is going to go away real quickly. And to be honest with you, if Coop doesn't break his collarbone, and I know it's a big what if, but just how he was riding the last 2 weeks, Dungy might not even get in the podium last night. So,
yeah.
Fourth and fifth place guys is not going to cut it anymore because he can't rely on the fact that the guys he's racing aren't winning. Like, they're consistent now for the first time since Dungy's been in the 450 class.
Well, let's talk about how Dungy looked last night. Let's get back to our podium here. Dunge did not look good all day. Qualified sixth. And the problem I think you're running into, if you go back to 2015 when Eli was spanking him all over the outdoors, and you watched, where was the second race at? Glen Helen.
Yep.
And you watched the podium interview when Eli spanked him by a minute again or whatever it was.
Caught him.
Defeated.
Yep, defeated.
Now, does he look defeated now? No, but there's definitely a lack of confidence in his voice. And the rumblings I keep hearing about behind the scenes is that he's having bike issues. He doesn't like the setup. So now we're going back to the old Ryan. Like the last year and a half, 2 years here has been Ryan Dungy, who was confident. Bike setup was good. He was going to the races knowing he was going to win. Now you're back to, I don't know if I'm going to win. Oh, I think the bike setup. Ryan Dungey of old, of chasing his setup around all stinking day. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's where we're getting back to. And let's face it, the guy's luck is running out. He crashed last year and broke his neck, back, whatever it was. And now, you watch yesterday on the Dragon's back in, was it the heat race? Or was it,
I think it was a heat race.
Yeah, because I texted you about it too. And he about ate it hard over the bars on that Dragon's back.
Yep, and he got loose in the whoops like three or four different times.
Mm-hmm. And I think in the main there was a thing we didn't see too. He got loose somewhere and went off the track actually. So, yep. I mean, you start putting all this together. His setup's not dialed in where he likes it. He's lacking confidence. And these tracks are getting just completely eaten alive. Because now we're going 25, 26 laps in the 450 and 20 everywhere. Laps in the
250
main. I mean, all of a sudden now, he's going to have an issue here. And you give him a week where he has a crash and he, you know, gets a DNF, gets 16th, 17th, 18th place.
Championship's right there.
I mean, you're looking at a 5-point spread between first and third. So it's going to be interesting to see how this goes the rest of the year.
And honestly, I think now that it is four races in the row, like I have this thing about Dungey this year. We got to stop giving him the benefit of the doubt. He still has the points lead, and he only lost 1 point to Marv, and you know Eli gained 5 or whatever it was, even though it's still 22 or 24. We got to stop giving him the benefit of the doubt because it's Ryan Dungey, and everybody's like, oh, he's sick, or you know, if it is the, which I think it is because the bike doesn't look that good. Mm-hmm. You know, even though Dungey is one of the strongest guys mentally to ever do this, you know, it doesn't matter how strong you are, how good your technique is. If you're fighting the bike, you're fighting the bike. We got to stop giving the benefit of the doubt. People saying, oh, he's doing just enough. Dude, Tomac got around him with ease, gapped him within 5 seconds within the first three laps. Marv catches him from 5 laps, and Dungey just looks mentally defeated halfway into the race. Now, I'm not saying that, oh, it's something where he's struggling with his technique or doesn't look comfortable doing the fast lines. He just doesn't look comfortable at all going the race pace.
Period.
And like I was telling you, that instance where Marv got around him, racecraft. Dungey had about a bike and a half length gap on him going into the corner. The natural thing to do would be square it off and close the line off on the inside. He completely goes to the outside and let Marv just run him wide. The old Dungey never would have done that because he knows, it's almost like he has eyes in the back of his head. He knows that Marv's going to do that because it's a shorter line. I think, guys, we got to start realizing that this is not, I know that the Dungey fanboys will say, well, oh, it's still Ryan Dungey. When's the last time Ryan Dungey's had a points lead and lost points when he's been that far out front? Dungey usually gets the points lead. Oh, he'll lose a point or two because he doesn't win. But it's never been every weekend in a row for 4 weekends in a row now. I mean, this has never really happened to Ryan Dungey. And I don't know. It's just not the same guy.
Interesting to see because next week is Mars track at Atlanta. So we'll see. Could be a battle between him and Eli. That'd be cool.
And honestly, I don't think Dungey's even close.
Nope.
Mm-mm.
Okay, let's move on. Final part of the video here. Let's talk about fantasy picks.
You can go.
No, I think it's your week to go first.
Okay. Wild card is 10th place. I'm thinking just because it's usually where he ends up. At first, I thought it was 12th, so I was going to go with Weimer. But I think with 10th place, I think he got 7th last night. I'm probably going to have to go with Brock Tickle. Top 5. We're going to really good dirt, red clay. Traction always stays in the dirt pretty much all the way down. Well, with the mains being longer, it might not so much for the 450 main, but traction usually stays in the dirt all night. I looked at the layout. It looks good. Going to be a lot of hype. Moto Fest, last race ever at the Georgia Dome. You're going to have a lot of the people there from the industry just because there's always craziness that's happened there. You know, everything going on with Arena Cross and the RCU and all that. So a lot of hype. That has nothing really to do with my picks, but I just want to point that out. Top 5 after going what happened last night, I'll go from 5th on up. I think 5th place, I'm probably going to have to go with Jason Anderson. You know, he's kind of fallen off. He got the heat race last night, the heat race win. That was good for him, but just did nothing in the main. Got into 4th and just didn't go forward. I think 5th place right around now, until he can get a start, I think it's good for him because he just has proved that he can't work his way through the pack once, you know, he gets a crap start.
Mm-hmm.
The 4th one, and it's kind of 2 weeks in a row right now, I think after this last weekend. I think Dungey, guys, I got to keep saying it. He's struggling really bad. You know, we're going to track where the dirt's good, so even if the track layout's not that good, it's going to break down. Racing's going to be a lot better. Tomac and Marv are going to assert themselves even further ahead. I think that Dungey is going to be far off unless something crazy happens this week. I think Dungey gets fourth. I know he got fifth last night, but once again with the dirt. Sealy is still his confidence. He's been top five consistently every race now. You know, it's good. The bike is good. You know, he was leading the main. I know that he went down and it was only a lap in, but who knows what could have happened. Maybe he could have got on the box had he not gone down the first lap. Second place, and I do agree with you earlier in the video, what you talked about. I think Marv's going to get second, and that'll just go to Tomac winning it. I think we could see a battle. You know, those two get 1-2 off the line. Marv likes Atlanta. You know, he trains at the Baker compound, so the dirt is not quite the same. More sand in Florida, but it's close. I think that Marv's going to be there. And I think that Tomac just kind of runs away with it as the main goes on. But I think those guys go back and forth most of the main if they get 1-2 off the line. But I think Tomac continues the win streak. And I think that he makes this championship look just keep getting closer and closer. And I think the time we hit Daytona, you know, it could be, you know, if Marv keeps getting second, like 12 points for him and 15 for Eli, whatever. I just think that Eli's, you can't beat the guy right now. I mean, really. Like, his confidence is up. The bike is good.
This is like in 15 when he was dominating outdoors. Like, there wasn't any touching him until he wrecks himself, which hopefully doesn't happen. Then, I mean, that's what you're looking at, you know?
And honestly, I don't see that happening because aside, like, if he doesn't have, like, I know he goes down in Arlington, but if he doesn't have that front brake issue, he gets up and, in my opinion, still gets second.
Mm-hmm.
So, we've gotten over this thing of Eli hitting, because really, he hasn't hit the deck all year. Like, praying he doesn't, but he hasn't hit the deck all year, so why would
probably
we assume?
Probably jinxing it right now.
No, you know what? No, I don't. But my point is, before you go, I don't think so. I think that we're kind of over that. He hasn't done it all year, so why would we assume now that he's gonna?
Yeah.
So,
assume the best. I mean, nobody assumed Roxon was gonna crash that night either, so.
So, Tomac, Marv, Cole, Dunge, Ando, and then Brock Tickle in 10th.
All right, yeah. I mean, my picks are going to be pretty similar. I'm going to start from the top down. I'm going to go with Tomac until someone proves they can actually beat him without him having a bike issue or whatever. Beat him heads up. Mm-hmm. Marv second because Atlanta's his place. Mm-hmm. Now, where we are going to differ a little bit, third place I'm going to put Dunge because I think he's still going to get on the box. He's still he hasn't quite fallen off the bandwagon yet, but he's still he's not winning.
They're just inching away.
Yeah, they're just inching away from him. Then I'm going to go with Cole Sealy in a solid fourth again, and Jason Anderson. And I mean, realistically, the last three, Dungey, Anderson, Sealy, you could flip-flop those three. I mean, put them in a hat, pick them out, whatever. It just depends who kind of gets a start and who's feeling it. Mm-hmm. Now, 10th place wild card, we're going to differ a lot here, too. I'm going to go with Malcolm Stewart.
Okay. I mean,
he's a solid 10th place dude. He usually
last night?
I think he actually got 10th or 11th.
Okay.
So, you know, I think it was 11th. He hits the deck usually every race, but he's fast enough to make it up. And he's getting better. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, he's racing himself into shape right now at this point. So, you know, week by week, he's getting better and better. So I think, yeah, he's going to pick it up. Solid 10th place finish. So unless something crazy happens in practice.
And honestly, from 7th to 13th, once again, we talk about it at the top five, you could almost do the same. Throw a blanket over it. And the guys flip-flop. I mean, nobody has really from that point even been consistent 1 week. I mean, look at D. Wilson. 4th, 12th. I mean, come on. I had him in 7th, and he just completely let down. So,
thanks for tuning in. Like, comment, subscribe. I like the comments. I like to talk to you guys about the stuff. So, I'll talk Moto all day long. And we will be back next week for
Toronto.
Going north of the border instead of south of the border.
Hey.
So, all right. Thanks for tuning in, guys. We'll see you next week.